Well, good evening, everyone. Let's call to order our Lynnwood City Council business meeting for this evening, Monday, April 10th, 2017. Councilmember Boyer, how about the flag salute?
I think I can manage that, thank you. Y'all ready?
Yes, sir.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Can we have the roll call, please?
Mayor Smith?
I'm here.
Council President Goodwin?
Pleased to be here.
Council Vice President Ross?
Here.
Councilmember Boyer?
Here.
Councilmember Cotton?
Happy to be here.
Councilmember Sessions?
Here.
Councilmember Sutton?
Here.
Councilmember Hurst?
Present.
Council's present, Mayor.
Thank you. Councilmember Sutton? Councilmember Sutton, are you ready to the approval of the minutes?
Yes, ma'am, I am.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Approval of the minutes. I move to approve the following minutes. The Finance Committee, March 23rd, 2017. Business Meeting, March 27th, 2017. And Work Session, April 3rd, 2017.
Second. I think Councilmember Ross seconded that, right?
Absolutely.
Any changes or amendments to the minutes? Councilmember Cotton?
I have one. It's on page 30-B-6. Or page 11 in your PDF, if that's what you were doing. You're welcome. On line 4, I believe I'm Councilmember Cotton, not Commissioner Cotton.
Oh. How did that happen?
FD1 would have probably made it, sure, change that.
Any other changes or amendments?
I wrote it down.
All right, all those in favor of approving the minutes with that change, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposition? Thank you. At this time, we're doing item number 35. Council President has a message for us.
Thank you, Mayor. I wanted to quickly go over some things as we near May and into the summer, that we know that this is an election year. So as the election and campaign season approaches, I just want to throw out some reminders that no elective official nor any employee of his or her office, nor any person appointed to or employed by any public office or agency may use or authorize the use of any of the facilities of a public office or agency directly or indirectly for the purpose of assisting a campaign for election of any person to any office or for the promotion of or opposition to any ballot proposition. Facilities of a public office or agency include but are not limited to use of stationery, postage, machines, equipment, use of employees of the office or agency during working hours, vehicles, office space, publications of the office or agency, and clientele lists of persons served by the office or agency. This is all found in RCW 42.178.555. So this is a state law, and I just want to remind not only the council, but any of those in the audience, that these are very important rules that the state has set for elections and campaigns to make sure that everyone who is running an election campaign for the propositions, any of that, has a fair chance as any of us or anyone that comes to the meetings on a regular basis has. With that being said, I also wanted to comment a little bit about the purpose and why we have citizen comments, actually more pointed towards council decorum for citizen comments. As you know, if you come into this building to a city council meeting, on the table out there, you'll find a sheet that's similar to this. And on this sheet, as citizens who wish to speak during citizens' comments, please note, and then it has a number of things, and I wanted to bring to attention some of these things. One, and most importantly, is number or letter E, that all remarks by citizens shall be addressed to the council as a whole. Any person making personal, impertinent, or slanderous remarks who becomes boisterous, threatening, or personally abusive or otherwise disrupts the conduct of the meeting while addressing the council may be requested by the presiding officer to leave the meeting. That goes for the audience as well as council members. You know, we have a duty as well to make sure that we follow our own decorum. That also goes toward any member of staff and any citizen in general. So when we come up to the microphone to speak, I'd ask that you use and speak in a courteous manner, especially when you're speaking of issues that may at some point be controversial, that you don't direct or point those toward any one person. When you speak to the council, speak to us as a whole. We'll gladly take criticisms. We'll gladly take compliments, but not to one specific person. If you do that, again, I don't intend this to be somewhere where I make or the mayor makes someone look foolish by asking them to sit down if they're going to do that. But that's the rules that the council has agreed to. So I'd ask that you would all follow those, and we'll do the same. And I would also ask that council members take accountability for that with each other. You know, if we're not perfect, if I do something like that, I would expect that someone would speak up and say that I'm not following the rules of our decorum. So thank you very much, and I'd appreciate everyone showing overall general respect. If I could instill some wisdom that my dad told me when I was 14, he said, "Ben, don't be a jerk." So I would ask the same. So thank you.
Thank you, President. So moving on to 40, a couple of messages from me. It's been a busy month already. The end of March on the 31st, our city, in partnership with United Way and Leadership Snohomish County, hosted a poverty simulation at Trinity Lutheran Church. There were over 100 people who participated, people who are service providers and volunteers from our faith community. And I'm very happy to say there were almost 50 staff, city staff there participating. I know, it was a great turnout, and every department was represented. And then there were several commissioners. Almost all of our human services commissioners were there, and some planning commissioners. So it was a great turnout, and we went through the scenario that gave us an understanding of the trials and tribulations that our impoverished community members are faced with on a daily basis. It was a very powerful experience, and we're looking forward to working on the next steps with our partners to better address the needs of our community. And I was honored to participate in two ribbon cuttings. CarMax is now open in Linwood, adding to our inventory of auto dealerships. I do believe we now have 26 dealerships that bring in $2.8 million worth of tax revenue to our city. They're an important community of people who do business in our city, and so we're glad to add CarMax to that group. They're very community-oriented, employee-centric, and we're just happy that they're here. And then the second grand opening that I attended was for the new Cirque Apothecary, which is a pharmacy that specializes in medication and tools for children with special needs, specifically autistic. And so from what I understand, Cirque is the first pharmacy of its kind in Washington State. It's another wonderful addition to Linwood as we work to create a welcoming community that supports the needs of our residents. Let's see, I want to also share, maybe George and Ian will do this, but there are two regional fire authority planning committee information meetings scheduled for this week. The first we're hosting in our senior center just around the corner here. That's April 12th from 3:30 to 6:30. So come join us, not for pancakes, but for root beer floats. And you can chat with your firefighters in a presentation from the RFA Planning Commission commissioners. Then the second one is on Thursday, April 13th, from 6 to 7:30, up at the Martha Lake Fire Station. Then just one more announcement, the Step Up Conference. I'm not saying this yet. After the proclamation, I'm going to tell you all about the Step Up Conference. It's a little teaser. Right. So let's move on to our citizen comments. I've got the sheet. I will call people in order as you've signed up on the sheet. We'll be given 3 minutes to come to the microphone. Please state your name and address. So Ted Heichel, you're the first on the list.
Thank you, Your Honor. Counsel. Actually, I got to sign up on the list when I was here for the afternoon meeting.
Oh.
Ted Heichel, 3820, 191st Place, Southwest Linwood. And I have attended most of the RFA Planning Committee meetings. The one this afternoon, I think, came to an interesting point when two of the fire district commissioners stated that it would be a deal breaker for them if you required the commissioners to be elected at a 2019 meeting, which would mean otherwise we would have the commissioners going on from 2017 to as far as 2024 before they would be up for election again. It would mean that there would be commissioners, at least one commissioner, if not more, who would be serving well into the future, who would not have stood for election in front of the Linwood electorate. That is a problem for me because I believe that the people are allowed, if they're going to be taxed, to have representation. And the way it stands now, with the commissioners just running on into the future, when there is no more fire district, they're elected as fire district commissioners, and there's no more fire district after perhaps even January of 2018 by the new legislation that apparently has been passed and is awaiting the governor's signature, it would mean that they would be able to continue on and citizens of Linwood would have no way to say whether they approved what they were doing or not. I believe it's very important for you to insist on the fact that all of the elected officials who will be serving on an RFA, if that goes to the ballot, that they be up for election in 2019, staggered terms, and hopefully 4-year terms instead of the 6-year terms the fire district commissioners are now used to, because the citizens of Linwood should have the opportunity to state what they feel should be the representation on any board that is going to be collecting taxes from them and providing services to them. Thank you.
And next is Carrie Lonigan-Dreek.
Hi, good evening, Council. Glad to be here tonight. Carrie Lonergan-Drakey, address on record. I'm here to talk about my opposition to the Regional Fire Authority as well. Quite frankly, it's disheartening to me that a number of council members who I served with back in 2012-2013, when this whole concept was put in front of the community before, and we decided very strongly that that was not the right move, that we are here again. The reason I'm opposed to the Regional Fire Authority are for two important reasons. First of all, there will be an additional tax on the citizens of Linwood via property taxes, which are already sky high. I'm sure I'm not the only one in the area to have experienced double-digit increases in the last 2 years. So to have another tax, another property tax, is very concerning. The other thing about that that's a little disturbing to me as well is that, to my knowledge, there hasn't been any discussion yet amongst the committee about reducing current taxes that the citizens of Linwood are already paying for the fire service. So it appears that we're going to be paying more for a lot less. I'm also concerned about the lack of control over the fire department. Right now we have 7 council members and the mayor who are accountable to the citizens of Linwood for this critical service. And we want to get rid of all of that and have elected fire district commissioners that may or may not be looking out for the best interests of Linwood. I don't think that's the right answer. So if not an RFA, what next? I do believe that it's time to rethink the meaning and the functionality of traditional fire departments. There's a number of jurisdictions across the United States and Canada that are doing just that. 80% of 911 calls are for EMS, and a large majority of these EMS calls are for non-life-threatening emergencies. So other jurisdictions have looked at or are currently experimenting with what are called rapid response vehicles, using those for certain EMS calls rather than expensive fire trucks, contracting with private ambulance companies for the most routine of basic life support calls has also produced significant savings for many fire departments across the country. I do think that continuing to share certain administrative and medical officer services with Fire District 1 makes sense, and I think there's lots more opportunity to be doing that with Fire District 1 and or other jurisdictions, i.e. Mukilteo, something that previous councils did look at. The long outdated delivery model in Linwood and other surrounding jurisdictions requires fundamental rethinking. I mean, look at all the changes that are currently happening in our society with technology. So now is the time for the City Council and the Mayor to double down on changing this delivery model instead of doing the same thing, expecting different results with a much higher price tag. Thank you.
Chris Young.
Good evening, City Council. I'm Chris Young, a retired Sergeant Major with the United States Army. I'm here on a thanks for the Verdant Building and the use of it as the veterans have used it. We've had 300-plus members use it in the last 3 months, which is a HUA. And if you don't understand HUA, that means everything, but no, I won't or no, I can't. Okay, so that's part of it. So we end up having that building, and it's great. And we were in charge of it. The Vietnam Veterans Association was in charge of it last month. Went great. So we appreciate that opportunity to have that building so those people can mend and heal a small amount of their bodies from PTSD or just talking to one another and conversing. So it's really great. And the other reason I'm here is on some of the tax issues. I moved here from Pennsylvania. Taxes are driving me crazy. My homeowners, I read it in a paper, I see it in the news. All I want you to do is take out a blank piece of paper and write on there how many taxes we pay. And do what you have to do for the people. We can't keep charging the taxes. I'm paying now, what's the tabs cost now for cars? It's ridiculous. I'm gonna pay for a thing that I'm not even gonna be able to use on the communication services. I'm not gonna use it. I'm 65. Am I ever gonna get to use it? You might as well tax 3-year-olds, because 13 years from now, they'll be driving. They'll be the ones needing tabs. So I look at this and I see all these taxes, and as the young lady spoke before me, it's getting outrageous. And I want you to think of every time you see this list that you put in front of you, because we do it in the military. We write down a list of things we got to accomplish and things we have to improve, and we try to check them off. If it's too much, let's look at it and rethink what we have to do with our funds. And I also understand that there was $500,000 in excess, and the City Council gave it to directors at a rate of 24% increase to 15% increase. That is not right. My wife is a retired school teacher, uncalled for. They don't get that kind of raise. Policemen put their life on the line every day. My brothers and sisters, they're paramilitary people. They see this, as we saw today again in San Bernardino, put their life on the line. And we give directors who are already making probably six figures, another 24%? Where did it come from? How do you do that? How do you justify to the taxpayers? That's uncalled for. So I just want to say the levies also come down, and it's about computers. Senior citizens I talk to in the community want computers for schools. But when they put on there a roof repair, that's under building maintenance. That's under a 5 and 10 and 15-year plan, not on a levy to fix a roof. That's under those building maintenance. That should have been taken care of with other taxes. Where are they putting those tax dollars? I just want to know some of this stuff. I called the school board. Where's this going? I'll pay for technology for kids, but a roof repair? Someone's spending some money and tax money wrong. So I appreciate the time that I've had here with you guys. This is the first I've been involved, and I appreciate this time. So thanks.
And Herbert Itinza, thank you.
Good evening, Mayor and Council members. My name is Herbert Atienza. My address is 17819 37th Place West, near the corner of Maple Road and 36th Avenue. I am here tonight because I was told that the city needs to acquire part of my property and cut down some of the trees on my property for a planned sidewalk and road realignment project. I was told that unless I agree to what the city wants, that part of my property will be condemned. I do not need to tell you that Maple Road and 36th Avenue West are very busy roads because they lead to the freeway ramps, the mall, Costco, and other places. It is not unusual when I get home from work to see from my front porch traffic that is at a standstill, like you would see in downtown Seattle. With the road realignment, I can only expect more users of the roads and the curb. The only thing between my home and that traffic and the pollution that it generates is a narrow strip of land, the trees, and a 5-foot fence. I am here tonight because I am appealing to your sense of fairness and neighborliness. I am asking that the city mitigate the impact of this project, the noise and the pollution to be caused by the project and the tree cutting. I am not for stopping progress, but I do not think that it should be achieved on the back of your residents. Thanks.
Thank you. Stephen Greenbaum.
Good evening, Mayor, Council. Reverend Stephen Greenbaum, 4224 184th Street Southwest, Linwood. If you'll forgive me, I'm here to say something, some words of thanks. This is a long meeting. I won't take a lot of your time. I understand that tonight you will be taking up the resolution to support Standing Rock. If you recall, I was here the night that you discussed it. And I just wanted to thank the five of you who talked about it and said that you supported it. It means a lot. It means a lot to those of us who marched. It means a lot to the Sioux of Standing Rock who are still in litigation, still struggling to have fairness. So thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who'd like to speak this evening? Elizabeth?
Hello, I'm Elizabeth 98037. I came last meeting because I am proud of my accomplishments I did last year with the Love Your Block grant. I am proud that I made the time to dedicate myself to a project that made my community healthier and safer. I made sacrifices and used excellent time management skills in order to create time. I also used white girl privilege of having the privilege to be labeled as a nut job as I wheeled my large yard waste bin across my neighborhood with a shovel. I know if I was a man, let alone a black man, carrying a large bin with a shovel, I had been labeled up as no good. We are here today to take a stance on racism. And even though everyone here can agree that racism is wrong, as a society, we disagree if our skin color has a factor on our opportunities, consequences, and consequences of our actions. Even though I am white, I have concerns of my son being labeled as a racist by doing something as innocent as repeating a joke or a lyric to a song. There have been people at this podium with conviction and passion berating the last city council for being all white. How dare an all white council represent a minority majority community? I ask, should one not run for council because they are white? Should someone not vote for someone because they are white? As appalled as I was when I heard this, and I've heard it more than once, I know that was not their true intentions. As being labeled as a racist is harsh, especially those who throw the accusations don't take the time to know the people they accuse. Police have had a hard time with the Black Lives Movement, and yes, some have called them racist. But there's a line between being racially profiling and being racist. In response to the Black Lives Movement, a an organization called TEAM, Together Effectively Achieving Multiculturalism, a topic to their annual Teen Diversity Essay Contest was white privilege. There was a wonderful, inspirational essay, including a black student's experience in a white neighborhood. I am thankful he had a venue and confidence to share his experience, just as I hope a Chinese immigrant, one of the few Asian firefighters in the nation, and only non-white member of the Fire District 1 board has the same opportunity to share his story. There are many reactions about this essay, including death threats, but most comments were like this. Well, I am white, have been all my life, and never had privilege. I raised a family with no help from the government, worked 2-3 jobs on and off, and barely hanged on to falling down house. Sorry. And now have to work into my retirement. I'm sorry. Into my retirement, and social safeties have been stolen by our elected officials just to give to the poor. When do I get my right privilege? Is this person racist? Are people who chant Make America Great racist? At what? Sorry. Sorry. At what point of history was America greater than it was today? It was in my history that I grew up in a place that went through a transition of a white flight. I had experience in my town going from resources to fund parks, fairs, libraries, and you name it, to like that they had nothing. This is where gang members became a familiar sight. My friends and I got by playing in the street, but as nostalgic as that is, in the streets of Linwood, in the reality of Linwood's traffic, this is extremely dangerous anywhere in town. Sorry, I'm almost done. As the flight was racially charged, as the original Reagan campaign of Let's Make America Great was a reaction to desegregation, I believe the current campaign of Make America Great is caused by another flight that's not racially driven. Many middle American towns are facing the challenges of their community members taking their profession, jobs, and tax dollars to bigger and more vibrant cities. Left without the resources provided by the consumer tax dollars, many are left with only resources welfare and food stamps can provide. Like most of America, Linwood also struggles with providing these vanishing resources of maintaining safe roads, safe parks for children to play. As much compassion and understanding I try to have, I continue to be tormented by the President of the United States pursuing this concept of Make America Great Again. Thinking America is not the greatest it is today is such disrespect to all those who fought for the civil rights that we all share today. As disturbed as I am with Trump's rhetoric, I am just as disturbed with the resistance movement. I do think it is important to support our president because the responsibility he has is greater than our differences. Since Trump won the election, I've been struggling with if the world is spinning out of control or am I spinning in control. And I admit, last week I spun a little out of control. With massacres going on in the news, some racially driven, some religiously driven, but mostly they're politically driven. That is why I was so disturbed as something as petty as how a fire department is funded would be thrown into a fight against racism. The world is confusing enough. I just hope that you get to know a person before accusing them as being racist. Hopefully we can get over our differences and work together to take a strong stance on racism. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there others who'd like to speak tonight? All right, thank you everyone. We'll move on to our item 60, presentations and proclamations. The first one is a proclamation for Earth Day. Councilmember George Hurst, if you would read it. Is there anyone here to receive it for Earth Day?
Anybody representing the Earth?
Anybody here for the Earth? No, for the Earth. All right.
Okay. We all are. Yeah, that's right. So I think it's appropriate that I get to read this. There are some of us on this dais that were old enough to remember the first Earth Day. And this was before global warming or anything like that. But it was an attempt, I think, to remind us that we're stewards of the earth that we live on and that it's our responsibility to take care of it so future generations can still enjoy it. So let me read this. Proclamation, City of Linwood, recognition of Earth Day. Whereas humankind faces tremendous global challenges affecting every community, including large-scale migration, extreme inequality, poverty, degradation of ecosystems, mass extinction of species, and global climate change, and whereas all people of this earth, no matter their race, gender, income, sexual orientation, or national origin,
have a right to a healthy environment, and whereas the youth of the world are our most valuable resource and represent a source of endless creativity and potential, and whereas it is necessary for the citizens of our global community to develop green jobs and to build an innovative and equitable green economy to combat the aforementioned global challenges, and whereas expanding environmental education and climate literacy is vital to enhance awareness about the environment, inform decision-making, and protect future generations, and whereas it is understood that sustainability will only be achieved by meeting the needs of the present without compromising the needs of future generations, and whereas it is more important than ever to act locally and cooperate internationally and defend the environmental progress that has been heretofore gained, and whereas it is vital to expand and diversify the global environmental movement to achieve maximum progress, and whereas Earth Day is an annual reminder of the constant need for environmental activism, stewardship commitments, and sustainable efforts, and whereas the City of Linwood, in partnership with Farmer Frog, will celebrate Earth Day with an Earth Day cleanup project to restore, remove invasive plant material, and place wood chips at Meadowdale Neighborhood Park and Future Pocket Farm from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. on Saturday, April 22nd. Now, therefore, be it resolved that we, the Mayor and City Council of the City of Linwood, do hereby pledge this Earth Day, April 22nd, 2017, to renew our commitment to the sustainability framework as expressed in our comprehensive plan as the path towards becoming the sustainable community envisioned by our citizens. And this will be signed by Nick Lemon Smith, Mayor, and Benjamin Goodwin, City Council President, April 10th, 2017.
So, good night.
Don't turn that off. So, I ask my fellow council members to join me in a motion to what?
Concur.
Thank you. That's the word.
Second.
Second.
Awesome. Thank you.
Let's get a third and a fourth in there.
And
Mayor, would you
all in favor?
Aye.
Or in any opposition? Thank you.
Thank you.
We'll move on to our second one, our second proclamation for Arbor Day. Oh. Councilmember Vice President Ross.
Thank you very much. Is there anyone here representing the trees tonight? I guess not.
Than the trees.
Then I'll just read it from here. Okay, thank you. This is a proclamation of the City of Linwood in recognition of Arbor Day. Whereas in 1872, J. Sterling Morton, noted politician, editor, and horticulturist, proposed to the Nebraska Board of Agriculture that a special day be set aside for the planting of trees. And whereas this holiday, called Arbor Day, was first observed in 1872 with the planting of more than a million trees in Nebraska. Whereas Arbor Day is observed each year throughout the nation and the world on the last Friday in April. And whereas Arbor Day is observed in the state of Washington on Wednesday, April 12, 2017. Obviously, we're breaking with tradition there. Whereas trees reduce the erosion of our precious topsoil by wind and water, cut heating and cooling costs, moderate the temperature, clean the air, produce oxygen, and provide habitat for wildlife. And whereas trees beautify our city, increase property values, and enhance the economic vitality of business areas. And whereas trees, wherever they are planted, are a source of comfort, joy, peace, and spiritual renewal. And whereas the City of Linwood will celebrate Arbor Day on Friday, April 28, 2017, with tree plantings at Lindale Park. Members of the Linwood Parks and Recreation Board, the Arts Commission, and the community are invited to help 5th and 6th graders from Cedar Valley Elementary plant trees to continue habitat restoration at the park. Now, therefore, be it resolved that we, the Mayor and City Council of the City of Linwood, do hereby urge all Linwood citizens to celebrate Arbor Day every day and to support efforts to protect our trees and woodlands. And further, we all urge all citizens to plant trees to gladden the heart and promote the well-being of this and future generations. Signed, Nicholas Smith, Mayor, and Benjamin Goodwin, City Council President, April 10th, 2017. And I would move that the council members concur.
Second. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Thank you. And our last one for this evening, Councilmember Boyer is on his way to the podium for our proclamation on Stand Against Racism, and Shannon Gall, who is our YWCA representative working with our homeless community, will be standing with him.
And since Shannon is here representing the YWCA, I'm going to ask for a couple of other folks to come and stand with me while I read this proclamation, folks who are actively involved in Linwood's specific stance against racism. Councilmember Ross, Councilmember Sutton, would you join me, please? Chief, would you join me? The folks that I've just called up serve alongside me on our city's task force on police relations with communities of color, and they are all leaders in that effort. Deputy Chief Jim Nelson's also been a part of that. Commander Steve Ryder's been a part of that, and a lot of folks from the community who a list too long for me to name. But I think it's important to note that this is not just words in Linwood, that we are putting our money, so to speak, where our mouth is. We're putting the rubber to the road, and we're working very hard with members of minority communities to make sure that racism is not only a forgotten item or a item in the past in our police department, but all through our city. Linwood stands very strong in this stand against racism. Here's the proclamation. Whereas all people of Linwood, regardless of race, creed, or ethnicity, deserve to be treated with dignity, respect, compassion, and justice. And whereas racism prevents individuals from fully participating in and contributing to their community, eliminating racism and racial discrimination will allow us to celebrate the richness of diversity. And whereas the elimination of racism can be achieved only with the participation of all people in dialogue, reflection, and action. And whereas our shared goal to advocate for increased awareness of the lasting and negative effects of racism in our communities, institutions, and personal relationships. And whereas the YWCA of Seattle, King, Snohomish, along with the city of Linwood, local businesses, community organizations, schools, and places of worship, celebrate diversity and advocate for the elimination of racism. Whereas in partnership with the leadership in Snohomish County and other organizations, the YWCA and the city of Linwood are co-sponsoring the Step Up, Understanding and Implementing Racial Equality Conference at the Linwood Convention Center on Stand Against Racism Day. And now, therefore, be it resolved that we, Mayor Nicholas Smith and the Linwood City Council, proclaim April 28th as Stand Against Racism Day in the city of Linwood. And we encourage our fellow community members to make a personal commitment to stand against racism. Signed, Mayor Nicholas Smith, City Council President Benjamin Goodwin, and Your Honor, I would move that the members of the Linwood City Council concur in this proclamation.
Second.
Thank you. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Do you want us to take a picture up there?
Yeah. You got a good group.
All right, I have some prepared remarks. As long as I don't forget how to read, I'll be good. Retired Navy sir, thank you for your service to your country. Thank you so much. My name is Shannon Gall, and I work for the YWCA, where we are on a mission to eliminate racism, empower women, stand up for social justice, help families, and strengthen communities. And we very much appreciate this proclamation. The City of Linwood is a longtime and valued partner of our YWCA, and I have the good fortune to work on behalf of Linwood residents as the YWCA's homeless engagement liaison. My program is more like a connector of sorts. I'm tasked with being out into the community and creating relationships and trying to connect services with the people who need them. So thank you for taking a stand against racism with this proclamation and highlighting this important issue. This campaign is part of our larger national strategy to fulfill our YWCA mission of eliminating racism. In Snohomish County this year, we are excited to be a partner, along with the City of Linwood and others in the community, and the new community-wide forum from Leadership Snohomish County entitled Step Up, Understanding and Implementing Racial Equity. The forum, again, is on April 28th at the Linwood Convention Center, and thanks to our sponsors, the event is free. As part of this event, we will all be taking the pledge against racism. You can find it online. For brevity, I'm going to not read it if that's okay. But if you'd like me to, I'll absolutely go for it. Thank you again for the proclamation, and we hope to see many of you on April 28th when we step up to fearless conversations about racial equity. Thank you.
Thank you. This way?
No, you're good. That's
right. Good?
Yeah. All right.
All right.
Yes, I can. Okay.
What's to you?
All right. 1, 2, 3. Cheese.
Cheese.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
So I'd given you the tickler about the Step Up Conference. I guess the only other thing I can add, because Shannon did a fabulous job of the advertisement, we're sending us 50 city employees and as part of our professional development with regard to racism. So looking forward to that Friday. Are there any written communications or petitions? We'll move on to item 80. This is time for council members to give their comments and announcements. And I'll be starting with Vice President Ross.
Thank you. Testing, testing. Okay, I guess it's working. I almost broke my microphone. I just wanted to briefly talk a little bit about something that transpired last Tuesday night, and Councilmember Boyer touched on it. We have a group that's getting together called, I don't know if it has an official name, but it is the Police Relations and Communities of Color group. And one of the activities that we decided on pretty early was we wanted to get together and watch the Netflix documentary 13th. So if anyone has any question about the existence of institutional racism, I cannot recommend that documentary too highly. I had a minor in sociology, so I kind of had an inkling about what was going on, but it really brought home for me the idea that there's a conversation we're not having right now. And that conversation is, what do we do? And I don't know who has the answers to that. But I think a good place to start is to become educated about the history of our country and what racism really looks like. So if you haven't seen it, I can't tell you how much you will be glad that you did if you do. Thank you.
Councilmember Sutton.
Thank you very much, Mayor. I have a couple of things I'd like to share. I also am liaison to the Human Services Commission that we have here at the city, and I want to recognize one of our commissioners, Kathy Coffey. She was one of several individuals that were honored as emerging leaders of Snohomish County, and I think that's just such a wonderful thing, especially for Kathy. Kathy and I and Mayor, actually, we worked together at one point in time, and it's just nice to see where our paths are taking us, right?
Right.
It's just amazing. Second thing is, I also am the liaison to the Arts Commission, and we have, I don't know how many of you have viewed the signal box that's in front of Big Lot, but There was another one that was done at Alderwood Mall Boulevard and 40th, just completed on Thursday, and it's interurban. So it has an interurban theme to it. It has water bottles, it has a bicycle, it has gears. Take a look at it. It's just really a wonderful feel to not only spruce up that area, but also just remind us that good health comes when we put the energy to it. And also along with that, on Earth Day, which we're going to have on a cleanup on April 21st, which is a Friday, we are going to be cleaning out, we, commissioners and the Parks Department and other volunteers, is going to be cleaning up that area. So as people cycle and walk around that interurban, they'll have a real nice view of not only the signal box, but also the cleaning up that's going to entail. So that's it. That's all I have. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Hurst.
Thank you. The mayor has touched on this. I'll just emphasize that there's going to be a public outreach on the Regional Fire Authority Wednesday, April 12th at the Linwood Senior Center, 3:30 to 6:30. If you can't make it to that one, there's at the Martha Lake Fire Station up by the Walmart on Thursday, April 13th from 6 to 7:30. I'd encourage anybody who has questions to come and talk to us. Along that line, last week, I was able, because I'm chair of the RFA Planning Committee, I wanted to do some research. So I did some ride-alongs with some of the firefighters from Station 15 here in Linwood. And all I can say is that, you know, the runs we went on were fairly mundane and probably for them not very impactful. But for me, being able to see how they operate, and then, you know, the two EMS calls that we went on, one was a cancer patient who was in the last stages of life, really, and then the other one was for a stroke victim. And I don't know how they do it, because the next day it bothered me what I had seen, and it's relatively minor. I mean, you think about it, you know, oh, this person has cancer, this person had a stroke, and it's like we hear about this every day. But when you see it, you know, I just admire how they can go through that every day. And, you know, I asked them how they did it, and it's basically, well, you're going on to the next one to help them, so you can't really think about what you saw. And then lastly, I think on the lighter side, I'm pretty sure he's not running for office, so I'm going to say happy birthday to my grandson, who's 5 years old, Aaron George. Thank you.
Councilmember Boyer.
Thank you, Your Honor, and it's a busy but wonderful week for me this week, and a special week for many of our neighbors, those who are practicing Judaism. Tonight is the first night of Passover, so to my dear friend Reverend Greenebaum, and all others who are observing tonight, good Pesach, and to all of my friends and neighbors who are practicing Christians, have a beautiful Holy Week. Reverend Greenebaum and I will be doing some interfaith celebrations on Thursday night, which is another night in Passover for him and his flock, and Maundy Thursday. For those of us on the other side, Good Friday is coming, and as my fellow American Baptist is famous for saying, it's Friday, but Sunday's coming. So for all of you who are looking forward to Sunday coming, have a blessed week.
Councilmember Cotton.
Thank you, Your Honor. Just a few comments. One, I know that you know, with the atmosphere and especially with the resolution about stand against racism, I think one of the things all of us can do is be willing to have those difficult conversations and ask the difficult questions to educate yourselves. You know, I'm a little ashamed to admit that it wasn't till very recent history that I kind of didn't have a real grasp on what white privilege was. And I really still don't, but I continue to have made myself a student of that. And so I would just encourage everybody, wherever you're at, whatever your origin, wherever you're from, just whoever you are, make yourself a student of people that are different than you, that are not like you. Reach across the aisle, reach across the way, introduce yourself and say, you know, I've always been wondering about this, and please educate me. And I think that if we're all humble in our approach to learn from our brothers and sisters, we can really do a lot of good just in that one simple thing. As Councilmember Boyer said, to all those who celebrate otherwise, happy Holy Week and all the other. And for my family, I know we're looking forward to Easter Sunday, because that's when Mom puts out a good spread. So, and also another birthday this coming Tuesday, tomorrow. Happy birthday, Mom. I didn't forget. And that's all.
Councilmember Sessions.
Thank you. And thank you, Councilmember Sutton, for bringing up the new artistic wrapped utility box. That particular box was a collaboration between the Arts Commission, as you mentioned, but also with the Historical and Heritage Committee, which I'm part of as liaison from the council. And so that was kind of a neat collaboration to include the history of our city in that art as well. And so if you look closely, you'll be able to see that. Good job, team. Also, does anybody know any cool moms? I know a lot of cool moms, but I'm going to tell you about a couple cool moms from the Edmonds School District. They happen to be Edmonds residents, but it's Erica Shelley Nelson and Aaron Ornness. They are doing some fundraisers called the Edmonds Mom Prom. $40 per person, 7 p.m. Saturday, May 6th in Mount Lake Terrace. And this is an 80s and 90s theme. But the reason why this is important, why this fund is important, is because these moms have joined together to raise money to put together a prom for Scriber Lake High School seniors. Scriber Lake High School in the Edmonds School District educates many of our area's very low income, many homeless and at-risk high schoolers all over Southwest Snohomish County. And because of the lack of PTA, they haven't had a prom, so these moms joined together to make it happen. And to get more details about that event, if you'd like to join in or help in any way, go to Facebook to the Edmonds Mom Prom Explanation Point page, Edmonds Mom Prom Facebook page. Also, I'd like to remind everyone about our conversations with council. It's a special meet and greet with the council that we have arranged in South Linwood at 7 p.m. on Wednesday, May 17th, and that'll be in the cafeteria at Cedar Valley Community School. And we plan to have translators there, Spanish translators there as well. We hope to see a lot of our different residents that don't normally and aren't able to usually come out to these meetings here at City Hall to join us that evening. Thank you.
And Council President.
Thank you. I just want to take a brief moment here and recognize some people. Each month, the Edmonds School District recognizes Students of the Month, and I wanted to just give a recognition to those students. I know that they work hard, and they do more than just school. They're involved in a lot of different activities. So, from Meadowdale High School, we have Selena Teckel and Ian McGahee are both recognized as Students of the Month. They both are either involved in sports and band, and then do a number of things outside of school. And then the Linwood High School, Takara Trong, he is a varsity in tennis and swimming. He has a 3.88 GPA, which is great for a student that is involved in so much. Now, there's one last student that actually really impressed me. Krista Brutman. She has a GPA of 4.516. I think that's higher than my combined GPA in high school. But, you know, that is amazing, because generally 4.0 is the high standard for graduating high school. That's valedictorian level, but she has achieved a 4.516. And you may not be surprised that her future educational goal is to pursue a doctorate in mathematics. She's planning to become a theoretical mathematician and possibly teaching at the university level. That's a lot of work, and that's amazing to see. So I wanted to congratulate her and the rest of those students that were recognized for being Students of the Month.
Thank you. We'll move on to item 90, business items and other matters. 90.1 is our unanimous consent agenda. Council President Goodwin.
Point of order. I'm sorry. Parliamentarian, do we need to assign a resolution number to the resolution in item E, or does it need to be pulled and voted on separately?
It should be assigned a resolution number. It will just get the next number.
Yeah, there is one on here.
I beg your pardon. I'm looking at page 90.1E5 and don't see it. Is it somewhere else?
It's here on my agenda.
Oh, it's on your agenda.
Yes.
But I don't have that, you see.
No. But when I
so you understand the question. Thank you.
All right, shall I begin? All right. Lucky for you, you get to hear me again. Would any council member like to remove any item from the consent agenda? All righty. Then I move to adopt the following consent agenda items. Proposed agenda for the Conversations with the Council Community Outreach event. Adopt the proposed agenda for the May 17th, 2017 Conversations with the Council Outreach event to be held at the Cedar Valley Elementary School cafeteria. B, Convention Center City Use Day request, volunteer appreciation. Authorize the mayor to approve one City Use Day at the Linwood Convention Center for Annual Volunteer Recognition Event, April 26, 2017. C, Convention Center City Use Day Request, State of the City Address. Authorize the mayor to approve half City Use Day at the Linwood Convention Center for State of the City Address. It'll be held June 1st, 2017. Final acceptance, letter D, final acceptance, Bike to Health Improvement Project. Authorize the mayor to grant final approval of the work performed under the contract for the Bike to Health project, subject to the requirements of appropriate state and federal agencies, and if any, and ultimately release of the retention to the contractor, if any. E, resolution, financial policies rewrite. This is where you may want to write that down. Adopt resolution number 2017-07. A resolution of the City of Linwood, Washington, amending the City of Linwood financial policies. Letter F, contract award, fire truck engine repair. Authorize the mayor to approve the expenditure of $36,741.24, inclusive of sales tax, to Cummins Northwest for the repair of the engine for fire engine 15. And lastly, letter G, voucher approval. Approve claims and payroll in the amount of $2,801,903.69 and $1,235,712.42, respectively.
Thank you. No public hearings. We'll move on to 90.3, other business items. And let me just give you a heads up that we do have a couple of new business items with regard to the RFA. So we will do 90.3A, B, and C, move into an executive session, and come back out for the new business items and adjournment. All right. So, A, resolution supporting Standing Rock Sioux Tribe. Councilmember Boyer.
Thank you, Your Honor. I move the council adopt resolution number 2017-08. A resolution of the City Council of the City of Linwood, Washington, in support of the rights of the Standing Rock Sioux Tribe's right to protect their sacred lands and in their right to oppose the Dakota Access Pipeline.
Second.
Any discussion? Would you like to speak to that, Council Member?
Sure. We've already talked tonight about racism. personal, systemic racism of all kinds. And there has been some, strong opinion offered by other folks in my other profession that the original sin of the United States of America was racism, followed shortly by near genocide of the native peoples that the Europeans found on this continent when they came. It's a racism that then led easily to other kinds of racism, the racism that allowed Europeans to think it was okay to take captive, essentially to kidnap, men and women from the African continent and bring them here and inflict on them the kind of, the worst kind of slavery this world has ever known, involuntary servitude. But for the United States, or what became the United States, it started with how we treated those people that Christopher Columbus incorrectly called the Indians. And there's no way to go back and undo all that. But what we can do is stand up and say no more. So once again, I give thanks to my friend, Reverend Stephen Greenebaum back there, and a group of folks that marched with him some weeks ago in support of the Standing Rock Sioux. I was not able to be there. Councilmember Ross marched with that group and initially received the proposed resolution from Reverend Greenebaum. We've cussed and discussed in work session, and now is the time for the City Council, the City of Linwood, to stand up and say we stand with our Standing Rock brothers and sisters and agree with them that what's being perpetrated in the North Dakota Access Pipeline is just more racism. That's all from me, Your Honor.
Thank you. Councilmember Sessions.
Thank you. While I plan to vote yes on this tonight because I know it means a lot to the supermajority of my fellow council members and many of our fine residents, I wanted to reiterate what I'd said when it was first brought up to our attention a few weeks ago, that in general, regardless of our personal opinions, I'm not in favor of us making resolutions or actions for national topics. I don't think it's our job on this nonpartisan Linwood City Council to do that. And where do we draw the line? I would rather spend our time and energy and the small power we do have where we can make a positive difference, focused right here in Linwood. Thank you.
Any other comments? Yes, Council President.
Thank you. I was not able to be at the work session where this was discussed. Similar to Councilmember Sessions, I have a concern with resolutions of this type, not this particular resolution. I understand the atrocities that have faced not just those that are Native American, but as Councilmember Boyer brought up, those that were brought over by other means against their will. And just in general, atrocities that have happened throughout the country, throughout the country's history. But I also have a strong sense that as the City Council, our duty is to the citizens of Linwood, understanding there are many that support this resolution, and they're here tonight, and that's fantastic to have that support. The job of the City Council is for us to maintain the city's business. I think as separate council members, as citizens, the greatest impact that we can have is for us to stand up and do these kind of things. So I also will support this because I do support the cause. the process for this, the way that this resolution has come, I don't agree with, and I think that that's something that we need to look at as we continue to do resolutions, to make sure that it includes every citizen of the city of Linwood. One of the things that I was looking at with this resolution is, I'm sure that most and many of our citizens do believe that the Standing Rock Sioux Tribe has the right to oppose the Dakota Access Pipeline on their lands. I don't think there's any doubt that any of us believe that they have that right to oppose that. But I think for us to speak for the city as a whole, that the city in general opposes the Dakota Access Pipeline, I don't know that that's correct for us to do. And that's where my concern lies with this. But again, I will support the resolution, because I do know that the work that is being done is right. It's correct. So that's all.
Vice President Ross? Well, all I can say is we can't do much, but we can do this. Thank you.
Councilmember Sessions? Or no, I mean Cotton. Sorry.
Thank you, Your Honor. I, for one, am just really proud of our city for taking what stand we can. You know, it's not a lot. It's like Council Vice President Ross said, but we're doing what we can, and I think that, you know, where your dollar is says a lot. And we're just resolving here that we're essentially going to be mindful with what we do with public finance with regard to how that impacts our brothers and sisters in the Dakotas. And so what we're saying really here is we're not going to take the dollars that the citizens of Linwood have entrusted us with, and we're going to work to be mindful about where we put those and make sure that our dollars don't hurt people elsewhere. So I'm really proud of our community for making that kind of stand.
Any other comments? All those in favor of adopting resolution? We'd like a roll call. All right.
Councilmember Cotton?
Yes.
Council President Goodwin?
Yes.
Councilmember Hurst?
Yes.
Council Vice President Ross?
Absolutely.
Councilmember Sessions?
Yes.
Councilmember Sutton?
Yes.
Councilmember Boyer?
Aye.
7 yes, Mayor.
Thank you. And thank you for being here in our audience and supporting us. All right, we'll move on to 90.3B. Council, this evening I would like to ask for your confirmation of Thomas J. Davis as our Chief of Police for the Linwood Police Department. In May of 2016, Chief Jensen retired after 20 plus years as a career Linwood Chief Police Chief. That was complicated. I wonder, he must have been tired. In August of 2016, after receiving high recommendations, Tom Davis joined our city as our interim chief of police. We conducted an internal recruitment process to fill this vacancy. Chief Davis participated in 3 thorough panel reviews. He comes highly recommended by our Linwood Police Department staff, our department directors, community members, and this city council. So it's my great honor to ask that the Linwood City Council confirm my appointment of Thomas J. Davis as the permanent Chief of Police for the Linwood Police Department. Council President.
I move that we as the City Council of the City of Linwood concur with the Mayor in confirmation of Police Chief Tom Davis.
Second.
Any other conversation? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Yes.
Sounds like there's no opposition there, sir. So where's the party?
Yeah.
Come for a photo op.
Do you want to include any of the deputy chiefs or anybody?
Deputy chiefs, do you want to come on up?
Administration?
How about everybody who is in the police department, come forward and help confirm and celebrate.
Kelsey?
Brian's kicking and screaming.
It is.
Come on, come on, don't be shy.
That's why we write him cheers who was on the phone.
That's what my tiptoes are for.
All right, 1, 2, 3.
All right.
All right.
Congratulations, Chief.
Thank you.
Do you want to say anything?
Well, can you be brief?
Yes, you should.
Please go to the microphone, Chief. No, at the podium, sir.
I know.
I don't have any prepared remarks. I just want to say that it's very humbling to be given this opportunity. And when I came here 8 months ago, I learned very quickly that there's an incredible police department here, full of amazing men and women. And I'm just honored to be part of that team with them. And with the support of council, it's been a joyous time, quite frankly, to be able to kind of open up the department and present it to the community, if you will. The foundation is there, and I look forward to being here for many years to come. So thank you again very much.
Thank you. So let me please share that we'll be holding a oath of office and badge pinning ceremony for Chief Davis next Tuesday. That would be April 18th at 3 p.m. at the Linwood Convention Center. Mark your calendars and join us for this auspicious event. Thank you. And if you want this paperwork now, you can, or I'll give it to you later. Sign on the dotted line. All right. Chief Senefer, how many minutes do we need in executive session? 10? 10 max? 10. All right, so we will retire to an executive session where we are getting a director background check. Not on Chief, we've already done his. Beth, are you ready?
So you put them on people for a good one?
I have, yeah, actually. I didn't insist on last little light of mine.
Yes, he's giving the thumbs. Yeah.
He's right. Oh,
all right.
Okay.
Welcome back to the dais, council members. We are moving on to item 100, new business. PowerPoints are coming your way. Councilmember Sessions has recused herself to avoid any perceived conflict of interest. And Councilmember Hurst will make the opening remarks.
All right, thank you. So This afternoon, the Linwood Fire Department and Fire District 1 Planning Committee Regional, I can't remember what it's called now. Anyway, we had our 11th meeting on the Regional Fire Authority, and it's coming to the point where we have to make some decisions, some solid decisions. And Councilmember Cotton and I and the mayor thought we really wanted the council to give us some feedback that is definite on a couple of issues. One concerning finance and the possible, including the fire benefit charge on the ballot measure, and the other one regarding governance. And so luckily we have a crack crew of support, and they are here at a moment's notice to give us a rundown so we can do some real hard thinking. So thank you. And I think Sarah's going to start it off, right?
I am. Okay. Thank you, Council Member. Mayor, Council, good evening. We, your staff work group, are here to give you an update on the items that Councilmember Hurst has mentioned for discussion and a few other key things that are in motion with the final stages of planning. So to review, what we've presented to you up to this point is a transition timeline. If the RFA plan, if you vote to send the plan to the voters, it would go to the August primary, and if approved, a new RFA would form on January 1, 2018. And between the August date and January date, the staff would work between the district and the city and the new RFA to form a number of ILAs to execute those before the end of the year. Under this timeline, the RFA will not be able to begin collecting taxes for their levy until the year 2019. And you, the Linwood Council, or I should say the Council of 2018, won't set a budget that doesn't include the fire department until we do the 1920 biennium budget and set the revenues needed in November of 2018. We've been through this. This is just review. The late breaking news is just last week, the state legislature passed legislation, Substitute House Bill 1467, that provides additional flexibility for regional fire authorities, with one component of that legislation giving RFAs flexibility in a start date or the formation date. And so your planning committee has determined that when this legislation is signed into law, that the proposed RFA, if approved by the voters in August, will form on October 1 of 2017. So what that effectively does are a number of things. It means that the staff have to be very busy working on drafting those ILAs prior to the August primary. There's 2 months worth of time where those drafts can be created. Once the election occurs, if the RFA plan is approved and the election is certified, then it gives the council until the end of September to execute those ILAs before the RFA forms on October 1. It also means that the RFA can begin collecting their levy taxes in 2018. So this has a substantial and significant change to the budgeting process for the Linwood Council this year through the mid-biennium budget adjustment period and setting the revenues needed to sustain the 2018 budget, a decision we previously told you would not be made until fall of 18 is now proposed to be made in fall of this year. It also means that there are a couple options on the table in terms of how those ILAs will be structured. It's not substantial to tonight's discussion. Just wanted to let you know that there's a lot of work that you will see on those ILAs as we move forward. And that the levy rate, the city levy rate, which is I'm currently set at $1.73. May likely be impacted due to the formation of the RFA, depending on which funding model the RFA moves forward with, and that's one of the key decisions that we want you to weigh in on tonight. Director Springer is going to give you a quick update, if this works. Maybe. It is on. I don't know why the slide's not advancing. I didn't transfer it to the, can you just hit the advance? I'll fix it, but you really need to see the slide for Director Springer to comment on. Okay, perfect. So. Is it frozen? Well. You have it on your packet in front of you, so maybe, okay, perfect, great. Director Springer?
Okay, so you've seen these graphs before. This is the projected total cost of the fire services projected from 2017 to 2022. You can see the top bar line is fully staffed with administrative staff. The green line is the with the four-person ladder truck. The third line down is the three-person ladder truck, and then the status quo is the purple line down at the bottom. if the RFA were to form in 2017, these additional costs of these six firefighters would go away for the city of Linwood. Currently, we do not have those six firefighters in our 2017-18 budget. It would alleviate us trying to find funds to cover those six firefighters. So that would be a big benefit of having it formed in 2017. The other slide shows the cost per $1,000 of assessed value with those different levels. The fully staffed cost is $2.81. You can see in 2019, the cost status quo stays around $2.13 per assessed value, which is exactly what our total property tax is in 2017. Now, if the RFA does form in 2017 and you set the property tax levy in 2017, which would occur in November of this year, you would not probably set it at the highest rate, which would be $1.60. You would set the amount of levy that you need to cover the expenditures that are occurring in 2018, less the firefighters, less the fire staff, the fire services. So your rate would be substantially lower. It could be as low as 13 cents if you wanted to make it just whole and not have any increase to the average homeowner. It would be $1.60, the maximum amount, but that would be a lot higher than you'd actually need to fund 2018 services for the rest of the city.
Beth, if we could go back one slide. In the text box, the second check mark is to the point that Director Springer was trying to make. Your mid-biennium adjustments would reflect a reduction of all of the 2018 fire department budget, less any of the transfers that would still need to be budgeted to pay the RFA for contract services and any of the other interlocal agreements and our EMS revenues. So there, in this scenario, the October 1 scenario, it actually is a sizable decrease to the city's budget starting in January of 2018. In the January 1 formation, the city is actually on the hook to pay the RFA the budgeted 2018 amount for fire service. So this legislative change is a big change to the city's budget occurring immediately in 2018. This slide is another representation of what that means. We've talked about the initial capitalization for the Regional Fire Authority. We are expected to provide a lump sum payment to the RFA, should the RFA form, of approximately $2.5 million, which is the estimate of the city's fire department ER&R balance at the end of 2017. That's for initial reserves and capitalization to the RFA. In addition, until the RFA establishes its own EMS levy, the city would be continue to collect our approved EMS levy, and those monies would be transferred to the RFA once we receive them. And then, in addition to those items, this is the general operating budget is still needed to cover either the first 3 months of service, October through December, or the full 2018 year of operation. This is the distinction between the two formation dates. In addition, if the RFA forms in October, the city would still need to make a $400,000 reserve contribution in 2018. The date could be set by an interlocal agreement, but that makes up the portion of the city's contribution to the initial capitalization. So as a review, and you've seen this several times, there are two financing models offered to regional fire authorities. The traditional model, which allows the fire authority to levy $1.50 per 1,000 AV to support all of the fire service, plus at some point in the future, they can authorize an EMS levy of 50 cents. The planning committee is not taking forward the RFA plan with an EMS levy in it, just that they can authorize the EMS levy at a future date. The other model, the fire benefit charge model, takes 50 cents of the property tax levy and converts it from a levy to a benefit charge or a fee. And I'm going to have Chief Eastman give you a quick overview of that fee.
So we talked about it the last work session. It's important to know that the fire benefit charge is not a tax. It's a fee for service. The initial vote or the initial vote requirements for a fire benefit charge is 60%. It's limited to 60% of the operating budget. You forfeit the third 50 cents of the fire levy, so your fire levy would drop from $1.50 to $1. It's good for a maximum of 6 years. If you remember the last presentation we gave you, it used to require a supermajority to renew as an RFA. The legislation that's passed both the House and the Senate changes that to a simple majority. So if we were to have the benefit charge as part of the funding model for the proposed RFA, renewal of that will be a simple majority instead of the supermajority. It's based on improvements to the property and resource needs. It's not associated with the assessed value of the property. The benefit charge is set annually by the seated board, and then the benefits need to be measurable. Here's just a snapshot of what the proposed RFA looks like. With your subcategories, the residential properties, commercial, mobile home, multifamily, and the square footage is associated with each one of the category types, and the percentage associated with that square footage. And then if we were to take the benefit charge and spread it out over those property classes based on the percentage of square footage, that's what this represents.
The RFA board, if they move forward with the benefit charge now or later, would have to set a series of policies that may adjust the spread or the apportionment of these fees across these different structure classifications. By doing that, the fire benefit charge allows you to shift the burden of that 50 cents of levy capacity into a fee that is based on the structure's need for fire response. That's based on square footage and not AV. One effect of that is you can shift some of that cost to commercial properties which require a greater response away from single-family homes. However, when you look at the single-family homes themselves, there's an opposite effect in that the fee is based on square footage and not AV, and so two homes of equal square footage but vastly different AVs pay the same fee. And so without a lot of exemptions or changes, mobile home categories and other low-income properties could be disproportionately affected by a fire benefit charge, depending on how the fee is set and those policies are created. So that is this is a quick overview of the pros and cons of fire benefit charge before you have your discussion. In the pro column, what's nice about a fire benefit charge is that it's flexible funding and it's set annually based on the budgetary needs of the RFA. It's a fee, not a tax, and it's based on potential fire resource rather than property value. It also allows for discounts. So there's a lot of flexibility in this model. In the con column, it requires an initial 60% supermajority authorization. So if it's included in the plan, then the plan, when it goes to the voters, will require a supermajority to pass it, versus just sending the plan with the property tax levy at $1.50. The voters would be voting just on the idea of forming a regional fire authority. It separates the issue, and then a fire benefit charge could be presented to the voters at a later time as an independent issue for an up or down vote. The fire benefit charge must also be reauthorized by voters every 6 years. And the attorney informed the Planning Commission today that including a fire benefit charge at any time, you do risk a challenge based on the apportionment model. So how those fees are set could risk a challenge, a legal challenge. And if you incorporate the fire benefit charge with the RFA plan, and those are approved together, you put at risk the formation of the RFA for an apportionment challenge, potentially. Fire benefit charges can be very complicated, and they require a significant amount of public education just on their own, in addition to trying to educate the public about what a regional fire authority is. So there would be a great lift or burden to the staff work group and the consultant to make sure that we adequately provide the information to the public in a timely manner ahead of the August primary, especially given the shortened time frame to October 1 transition date. There's already more work the staff are planning to do to create those ILAs and put other systems in place. And then, as I mentioned on the previous slide, it does provide some policy challenges to address single-family home equity for low-income dwellers. And so there's just the thoughtfulness that needs to be put into the apportionment process and policies.
Yep. It's also important, the legislation that was just passed by the House and the Senate exempted housing authority properties and properties like. So that's new, and it will be in statute when it becomes law, when signed by the governor. So that has been dealt with legislatively.
So before we move to the remainder of the slides, which deal with governance, this is a good opportunity to hand it back to Planning Committee Chair, Councilmember Hurst.
All right. Yeah, so this is one issue that I think we need some clear direction on. There are a few more pros. It does, a fire benefit charge does give you a little more reliable source of revenue. Property taxes are based on AV, and when the recession hit, Fire District 1 had some challenges because they lost a lot of revenue as AVs went down. The personally myself, you know, I have gone back and forth on this thing, and I am still inclined to want to include the fire benefit charge, more because I've heard on the committee that eventually this will be in place. Fire District 1 planned on it before. It was stopped because they couldn't figure out, the Snohomish County could not figure out how to actually bill it through the tax mechanism that they had. So now that has been settled. They have resolved that issue. I know there was, Ms. Olson talked about the challenge as far as apportionment challenge, but I think Councilman Cotton asked the attorney, has any RFA faced that, and they have not.
Councilman Cotton.
Just to kind of fill in, because some of the discussion, Councilmember Hurst and I felt it was important to kind of give council a third touch on this, because it is a lot to take in, and we did kind of present it one way and then go, oh, wait, we need to kind of give you fire benefit charge 101. And anyway, I think this third touch is a good one. I think that a couple things are important. One, the stabilization of funding is a good pro, but really kind of my heart in bringing this back to you all is when it first came forward, we kind of got a general kind of nod around the table, yes, and then when it came back, it was like, well, actually, maybe not. And as I've been hearing our kind of heart up here in unison about, you know, kind of social justice and equity, it seemed to me that, one way that Linwood having the lowest median income in the surrounding cities, having the largest population of minorities, and just kind of overall, you know, we kind of have a lot of the socioeconomic challenges facing a larger city in a small package. So it seemed to me that it was be an appropriate way to bring this back, just for us to touch one more time. The fire benefit charge does have a lot more challenges as far as it's a little bit more complicated, but it does allow us a lot of opportunity to dial the knobs in an appropriate way, given how complex Linwood is. So we just kind of wanted to bring it back one more time and make sure you guys had enough exposure to it and that we got a clear direction from you. I will say, in full disclosure, kind of sitting on the committee, I'm leaning towards a recommendation of having the fire benefit charge. I think I actually really like it. But I want to hear from all of you guys on what your thoughts are on this.
Councilmember Boyer.
Thank you, Your Honor, and thanks always to staff for a great presentation. Thank you, Councilmember Hurst, Councilmember Cotton, for sharing your thoughts. Like you guys have both said, I've gone back and forth on this, and I guess part of what troubles me, concerns me, is that the phrase, George, is the complexity of the situation. You know, I like to think of myself as a pretty bright guy, and I've had a lot of trouble getting my head around how the fire benefit charge works. And I think about the fact that, you know, as we present this to equally bright people in the general public, but those who haven't had the benefit of staff's careful explanations over hours of meetings, folks are going to look at this and say, I don't get it, forget it. You know, it's too complicated, I don't want it. Because that tends to be our reaction when presented with really complicated, nuanced situations, is what's the easy answer? And I think for many people, the easy answer is going to be no. However, what we've just heard about the legislature's action indicates to me that, you know, there's the scenario, as Director Springer outlined, that we can go to
the public and say, look, here's this idea of an RFA. It's going to produce economies of scale. It's going to produce better coverage in the long run, fire service, CMS service. And here's the good news. It's not going to cost you any more money than you're paying now. Because as Director Springer points out, the money that would be assessed in a property tax levy by the new RFA can quite possibly come completely out of the Linwood levy, right? So that means the folks currently in FD1 aren't going to pay any more. The folks in Linwood aren't going to pay any more. It's going to be a win-win situation. I like that a whole lot more than saying, well, let me tell you, what was it, Chief Eastman, that's called? The fire quotient? What was that?
From last meeting?
Yeah.
The cost per gallon?
The cost per gallon, that's it, which I still don't understand. And Chief Eastman was very patient with me in trying to explain it. So, you know, my kind of gut level is, look, we can either present this really complicated, mind-bending proposal to the general public, or we can say, here it is boiled down to its essence. You're going to have better service, and you're not going to pay any more in taxes. So to me, is the fire benefit charge possibly going to be a good idea in the future? Sure. But let's let the new RFA and all of these good people, or actually the people who will be on staff at the RFA, figure out how to do a much longer conversation with the voters than we're going to have time for. Really educate them on how this works, and then ask them what they want. So that ultimately it's the people voting on each question. Do we want an RFA? Yes or no. Do we want to later come back in and change the funding mechanism? Yes or no. And that way the people get to decide. So I just like that for a lot of reasons.
Vice President Ross?
Yes, thank you. I also want to clarify that what we're discussing this evening is whether or not we include the benefit charge on the ballot measure. It doesn't mean that we're never going to have a benefit charge. It just means what we're asking, my personal opinion is, what we're asking the public is RFA, yes or no. How eventually it ends up being financed will be decided by the public. So I do not have any problem with not including the benefit charge, just creating or putting out the effort to get the vote on whether or not people want the RFA. And this is going to be a new entity, and there are going to be challenges, and there are going to be things that the entity itself is going to have to decide and put out for the voters. And that, I'm more than happy to let them do that.
Council President?
Thank you. I believe I said this at the last meeting, and I'll say it again. I see the RFA and the fire benefit charge as separate issues. You have the RFA, yes or no, and then the fire benefit charge, yes or no. As probably most council members, I've gone back and forth on the whole issue of RFA, on the whole issue of fire benefit charge. And like Councilmember Boyer brought up, because it's such a complicated issue in and of itself, and this is the fire benefit charge, I think putting that along with the RFA would convolute the real question, which is, do we want an RFA? If it's voted yes, okay, we want an RFA. If it's voted no, then no, there's no RFA. And if there's no RFA, we don't even have to worry about fire benefit charge. But because that issue is so complicated, it needs to be by itself with an explanation by itself of what exactly this fire benefit charge is, what it entails, what is incorporated in the fire benefit charge. And that, I think, needs to come by itself as an issue by itself. And then the RFA comes as an issue by itself for itself. So that's my thoughts on that.
Councilmember Sutton?
I have a couple questions here. Pardon me. I'm on page 7, and this is a question that just kind of triggered in my mind here. It says, the last statement, it says, benefits must be measurable. So what does that mean when you say benefits must be measurable? Is there a checkoff list of some sort, or I guess I'm not quite understanding what this
is. It's very subjective.
Okay, so
it's very subjective when that's directly from the statute that says the benefit must be measurable, and it can be a very subjective measurement.
So my next question is then, how do we know that this is going to be a better benefit? If we have nothing, I'm a visual person. So if I can't see something and understand that how it functions with outcomes, then I'm very confused here, I guess. Because if you're saying it's subjective, to me that means that there's really nothing really definite that you can give me that's going to tell me that this is a better
way of going. So when they talk measurement, they talk about comparing yourself to agencies that already have benefit charges in play and how they set and how they apportion the benefit charge to the different property classes. Most agencies that started the initial benefit charge was done based on the square footage, based on property type. So they did the slide you saw that showed 73% of the residential or the square footage is residential. They attribute 73% of the benefit charge to those properties, and that's how they measure it. That's how they do it. Kent has gotten a little bit more sophisticated. Renton uses some help from Kent when they just formed their RFA, and they have some other things that they add, for instance, building classifications for their commercial occupancies. They have hazard classes that they have, and the reason they're able to do that is because they have the database within the fire department to do it. The challenge we have with the proposed RFA is we get our information to do the benefit charge from the county. So we're limited on how we can do that based on what the county gives us for information, at least to start. That doesn't mean in the future we can't make the benefit charge and how we proportion that to the categories of property types differently in the future. The challenge right now is the county has very limited data. They have how big it is, they have how many square footage it is, they can tell you what the property is used for, and they can tell you with commercial and multifamily what square footage is sprinkled and what square footage is not. And that's where we're limited, unless we get the data ourselves and maintain it, or we convince the county to go and start capturing some of those information. And can use those to refine how the benefit charge is proportioned to the categories.
Okay. The second thing I have is, did I understand that the exempt public housing will be exempt?
The new legislation exempts public housing okay. from a fire benefit charge. So if it's just the $1.50 property tax, they're exempt from the full amount property tax, and the new legislation makes it so that they're also exempt from the fire benefit charge, which wasn't.
You broke it. You broke it with your questions.
Hey, Sarah, you want to give it a try?
I'm on.
Hello?
Oh, good.
Yay. Okay. So to try that again. So under current law, public housing is exempted from the property tax, the $1.50 levy, but not in the 50-cent fire benefit charge. So in the traditional model, they're exempted from the $1.50. In the fire benefit charge model, they're exempted from the dollar property tax, but not the 50 cents for the fire benefit charge. In the new law that's going to take effect, the 50 cents of the fire benefit charge, they are now exempt from that portion of the fee.
Thank you very much.
Councilmember Boyer.
Thank you, Your Honor. I want to come back to something Chief Eastman said just a moment ago in response to Councilmember Sutton, which is, and this is something, Bob, that you told us last week, too, and I hadn't really worked it through yet. The county doesn't have good enough information right now for the new RFA to be able to really get careful about assessment of benefit charge. But once the RFA, if it is formed, then the RFA will be able to collect that information about sprinkled, non-sprinkled, use of buildings, and so forth, and then be able to make probably more equitable, just decisions about how a benefit charge is assessed with that information, which would probably be collected over the first, I'm guessing, 2 or 3 years of the RFA's existence. Do you think that's a fair assessment?
Well, I'll use residential sprinklers as an example. There are residents out there that have residential sprinklers. The problem is we don't know who they are, and they're not in the county tax. They're not in the database that we get. For example, we could ask for those people that have sprinklers to let us know. We could go verify. Once we had that information, put it in the database. Once we have it in the database, it stays, and we could actually give a sprinkler discount for residential properties, for an example.
Right. Yeah, that's what I'm thinking. Okay, thanks very much.
And if I could, I wanted to go back to help Chief Eastman's answer to Councilmember Sutton. When Chief Eastman says that the measurable, what's measurable is subjective, it's to say that the RFA will have options to choose what they measure. And right now, their options are limited to square footage or classification of structure. But as Councilmember Boyer is suggesting, if the RFA did a couple of years of data collection, they could get more sophisticated and choose different measures for the fire benefit charge.
Thank you.
Councilmember Hurst.
Yeah. Something that Chief Eastman reminded me when he started talking about Brenton and Kent. Now, when they created their RFA, both included a fire benefit charge in that ballot measure. And as complicated as we make it, those voters were able to figure it out. So I have confidence that the Snohomish County voters can figure it out also. But I do have a question that was brought up because of this new change where we may be speeding things up. So Director Springer, you mentioned at what property rate would we go down to if we just said there's going to be no increase to the...
Well, the maximum property tax rate, as you know, would be $1.60.
Right.
But that would generate more revenue than what would be needed because we would eliminate the cost of the fire department.
Right.
So if we wanted to stay whole and be exactly what our rate is now, $2.13, that would mean that we would have $2 for the RFA devoted to the RFA and 13 cents for the city of Linwood. That would generate about $775,000 worth of revenue. So it's somewhere in between that 13 cents and the $1.60 that the city would need to assess. We would need to determine what the amount of revenue needed to cover the expenses of the remaining departments
and then the rate would be set by the Snohomish County Assessor's Office. But it doesn't mean that we're going to tax the max at $1.60. It means somewhere in between whatever is needed to fund the rest of the city services would be established.
And right now we're just talking property tax.
Yeah.
And just to clarify, the $1.60 max is in the traditional funding model for the RFA. If you choose to include the fire benefit charge, it actually goes to $2.10.
Councilmember Cotton.
Just a process question for Director Springer then. Part of that conversation is part of the mid-biennial amendments then, right?
So absolutely.
That would be kind of a post-RFA world mid-biennial budget amendment process.
Yes, we would show a financial forecast without the fire department there, what revenues would be needed to cover the expenditures of the city.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, Council President.
Thank you. So to Council Members Cotton and Hurst, do you have what you need to take to the committee? Or is there something more that you're looking for? I mean, I think we also talked about governance was another issue.
That would be good.
Yeah, okay. That's coming next.
So with regards to the fire benefit charge, do you have?
Yeah, I'm hearing Boyer, Ross, and Goodwin say put just the RFA on the ballot, save the fire benefit charge for later, and Sutton's council members, Sutton kind of in a similar boat or fire benefit charge. Okay.
Could I say one additional thing about the fire benefit charge that's not on the screen? The fire benefit charge would be a fee, and as we're all preparing our tax returns now, you know we can only deduct taxes. So technically, the property owner would not be able to deduct the fee from their income tax calculations, from their adjusted gross income. Just another thing to think about on your itemized deductions. But I know that the similar situation is with the vehicle tab fees. There's some fees and there's taxes. Technically, you can only deduct the taxes on your vehicle license renewal fees. But this would be a similar situation. Technically, you could not deduct the fire benefit charge as coming from a CPA.
Thank you. Okay. Yes, so I think that we could go.
Yeah, now we're going to talk governance because that's another.
You are ready to move on?
We are ready to move on.
Okay. So we are moving ahead the slides, and Mr. Bond.
Thank you. Just to recap where we're at, and a preview of what's ahead, we're down to one remaining outstanding issue on governance. What we have agreed upon so far on the permanent governance structure is a seven-member board with ability to add in the future. Five will come from districts, two will be at large. They'll be elected for a six-year term. The transition board, which is will govern the RFA from the moment of creation until we transition them out. That's what we're discussing right now. Based on last Monday's recommendations to your colleagues here, the discussion today was about what the composition of the board would consist of. The issue was either a 3-2 representation, 3 from District 1, 2 from Linwood, or a 5-2, 5 from District 1 and 2 from Linwood. Again, just this transition composition. It was decided, the recommendation from the council based on last Monday was to move forward with a 5-2. So that was accepted, I guess, by the planning committee today. So that issue is now resolved. So the last remaining issue that we have is how long of a transition period should we include in the plan? And basically, I think we're down to two options. One is a two-year transition term, whereby all of these positions would be elected by the residents of the future RFA in 2019. Some of those positions would need to be truncated for certain periods to adopt into a six-year term, and the other option would be a four-year period, whereby the appointees, some appointees would stay on for a four-year period. And so what I'm going to do is I'll brief you on some of the discussion points, particularly from your colleagues on the district side, so you can hear what they're thinking, and then also kind of unwrap what this means. So the short of it, in a two-year transition, again, if you look at that, there would be three positions, three of the seven elected for a full six-year term in 2019. Two would be for a two-year, and four would be for 4 years. So that means that four positions,
two
at 4 years and two at 2 years, yes. Four, and three at 6 years. And so four of the seven, essentially, are going to have some kind of truncated term. On the four-year, in 2021, two of those positions would have a two-year term. But they would all effectively be elected, you know, at a four-year, by 4 years. I had one other thing to say. Lost my train of thought.
I think you were going to say that by 2021, all seven positions would be elected by the full RFA voters.
That is correct. sorry, it's late. So let's get to the discussion from District 1 commissioners. So Commissioner Metter, he expressed concerns that this was punitive against him personally. So he was wondering about that. So he was trying to get at the logic behind shortening the term. He also said if it was critical, he would be okay, but he needed a good salesman as to why. But he made it very clear that right now that there are three commissioners against the two-year proposal. Commissioner Chan is out of the country right now, but they indicated that in an email message, he made it clear that he would not support 2 years. Commissioner Schrock, he concurred. He said he is opposed to a two-year term. And then he also started talking about running all at large, but I don't think we need to be discussing that any longer. Finally, I think where we're at here, I finished the conversation by asking very directly if this was, basically, if this wasn't such an important item that they would be willing to let this fall apart on. And both Commissioner Metter and Commissioner Schrock indicated that it was indeed a deal killer. And that's a pretty powerful statement. So that's where we're at here.
Could you put up the slide that's the deal killer?
One of the arguments that Jared hasn't mentioned yet that has been brought up by the commissioners is something that was brought up by you the first time we discussed governance, which was by doing an all 2019 election, you conceivably could have seven brand new commissioners. And if that were the case, that could be quite a shock to the system in terms of stability to the RFA. And so by doing staggered elections over two election cycles, you allow for just a little bit of buffer in that transition period, whereas you keep some commissioners who have history and human capital on the board and allow for that transition to just be staggered out just a little bit, ensure that you have some continuity between the election cycles. Whether all seven positions would truly be elected to new individuals is probably unlikely, but it is a scenario.
I remember what I was going to say now. on the four-year transition, I think it's very obvious and it's clear on the record that they generally prefer that because that means two of the commissioners get to sit out or ride out, whatever, I know that sounds vulgar, the entirety of their elected term. So in this election cycle, Commissioner Chan is up for re-election. And if elected, he would have a six-year term. Now, in the four-year transition, his position was one that would have been truncated to 2 years. However, Commissioner McGahey, who sits on the Planning Committee, and Commissioner Kenney, they would be up for re-election in 2019, so they're kind of amenable either way. And Commissioner Metter and Schrock would be up for re-election in 2021, hence their desire to for a four-year transition.
Councilmember Boyer.
Thank you, Your Honor. So if Commissioner Metter needs a good salesperson to explain to him why it would be a good idea for us to go with a changeover in 2019, I would suggest that a meeting be set up between himself and Mr. Heichel, who spoke very eloquently earlier this evening about the way in which the staggered, prolonged, elongated, whatever other word you want to use, schedule disenfranchises the voters of the city of Linwood. So that's point A. Point B, if Commissioners Schrock, Metter, and Chan are saying that this is a deal breaker, then I would say that they are putting their own political aspirations above the good of the citizens of both FD1 and Linwood. I find that objectionable, if I use a clean word. Also, the point's been made that it would be good to have commissioners around who have, I think the term was personal capital. I don't know that Commissioner Metter at this point brings much personal capital. I'm not going to sit here and call him a racist, but any politician who's dumb enough to make the kind of remarks that he made on recording and thinks he can skate is probably too dumb to run a fire district. I'm sorry if that's harsh, but that's the way I feel. So tell Bob that if he wants to take it up with me, I'll also be glad to meet with him.
Council President.
Thank you. So I'm changing the thing that I was going to say. About an hour and a half ago, I spoke about decorum. Councilmember Boyer. I understand the gravity of the situation and especially feelings about that, but I'll direct this comment to everyone. Please, personal thoughts, feelings about those issues. I would say this is not the place for those. We're trying to conduct this business, and I would ask each of us to keep personal type attacks. Keep those away. I understand if there are issues that affect us and affect the fire district, those can be brought up. I understand situational issues, but I don't think personal attacks or issues have place for us here. So just remind us all to keep that at bay, please. Secondly, my question goes to Jared Bond. If I understood correctly earlier this evening, someone had a concern that some of the commissioners would actually be serving as commissioners for longer than their six-year term. Is that the case? If we go with the four-year option, is that the case, that they actually will go longer than a six-year term?
No. I'm glad you brought that up, because I think that's an important point of clarification, that in neither one of these models that we're proposing or even discussing here to put in the plan would have any appointed person on the board longer than 4 years. So at 2021, that's when everyone's voted on, essentially. So,
point of clarification, if it forms October 1, it would be 4 years, 3 months.
I think if I could point out also on the position number 3, which is currently Commissioner Chan, if he gets reelected, even on this four-year transition option, he will have a four-year term, not a six-year term.
Councilmember Cotton?
Just a point of clarification, and staff, I'm going to rely on you a little bit, because we spend a lot of time together. Thank you for that, by the way. I think I owe some of your significant others Starbucks gift cards or something. Have we ever taken a deal breaker stance at the city?
At the planning committee level?
Yeah. Or at the council level, have we ever said?
I can't speak for the council, but for what I've witnessed amongst the planning committee, we are just now at the final big decisions, and so it's still an active negotiation, if you will. None of the planning committee members have said to the planning committee members on the other side of the aisle that there's a deal breaker.
I thank you. That was my memory too. I don't think we've ever, as part of the city, said it's got to be our way or the highway. So,
Jared,
well, I just correct me if I'm wrong, but I think, with the exception of the one vote today, pretty much everything has been unanimous on the planning committee.
That's correct.
Okay.
Vice President Ross?
I just have a quick question. When you talk about the four-year versus the two-year, in the four-year transition option, it's actually only two election cycles, is that correct? Okay, so we're looking at one election versus two elections. Okay, thank you.
And by statute, the RFA would need to be in the odd year election cycles.
Councilmember Hurst.
So back to the original question. We have the two-year transition is considered a deal breaker with three commissioners. What does the council feel? Besides, I think I know what Councilmember Boyer feels.
Council Vice President?
Okay, well, as unfortunate as some of this has become in the last little while, I actually am not terribly uncomfortable with the four-year versus the two-year. I can't say that I'm overly comfortable with it, but I do see the point. So I would not, in my opinion, neither one is a deal breaker for me. That's all I can say.
Council President?
Thank you. I also am not terribly concerned one way or the other. I am concerned that it seems the 2 years not even being considered. That's disconcerting me a bit. I do understand the point of having all of the positions being up for election in 2019. There is a possibility, not likely, I understand, but yes, there is a possibility that we could have all new commissioners, which I think would be detrimental to whether it's an RFA for just the fire district themselves. I mean, having all new commissioners, unless it's someone that has served previously, I think that could be detrimental. But again, it is very bothersome that there is such a hardline stance on the 2-year period. You know, that I don't like the thought of that. But again, either way, I'm really okay with the transition plan as long as it works, and as long as we have what we need to accomplish, what needs to be done. And I think both transition plans could do that. So I'm not necessarily one or the other. I can go either way on that. I do have concern about such a hardline stance on one. So.
Yeah. Councilmember Hurst?
Yeah. I would just say that the point I tried to make this afternoon, I believe, was that the RFA is a new entity. These fire commissioners were elected to represent Fire District 1. They now no longer just represent Fire District 1. We need to have a new board because it's a new entity. And, you know, I don't think that there are people that will not run again that are commissioners. But, you know, even if they do, let me tell you, I think I've said this before, I've attended a lot of those meetings for the fire commissioners. And sometimes I think they need to keep in mind that they are policy, but there are staff that know how to run a fire department. And they will be there to advise, if they're all new in 2019, they will be a capable staff there to advise any commissioners. And so I just, I think it's unfortunate that the stance was made, and I tell you, the union representatives wanted to make sure that they knew what they were saying, these commissioners, because I think there's a, you know, we've done a lot of work on this, and, you know, there's still some issues, but to have these commissioners, of which two of them were involved in this situation, be the ones who are voting to say this is a deal breaker, it's hard to take for me. Thanks.
Councilmember Cotton.
I guess, would it be okay, I think, with council as a whole, if we came back with a statement that said that the city is disturbed by the hard line taken by the district on this, and that both the fact that the RFA is a new entity and that there is very competent staff to help a new board out, that we just really need the commissioners to strongly reconsider their stance and be amenable to having the dialogue and not dictating terms. Is that something along those lines? I mean, I don't think it's a deal breaker for us, but because I don't want to get into a mudslinging contest, but I think if everyone's okay with us taking a hard stance and saying, because I'd like to push back on this, and I think that it's in the interest of the city to do so.
Councilmember Boyer?
Yeah.
Just a second. Shirley, no, just after Boyer.
I was recognized. Thank you. Ben, I promise to be good. First of all, let me say that I appreciate Councilmember Hurst, Councilmember Cotton's leadership in this, and I think that I would concur with them that with all of the work put into this, this should not be a deal breaker. But
boy, it makes me hot under the collar to have these guys say what they're saying. And just one last note on, you know, personal capital. Councilmember Hurst, you mentioned the representatives from the unions. And correct me if I'm wrong, Chief Redding, but FD1 has operated for how long without a valid contract with their union?
3 years.
3 years. 3 years. Now, most of you don't remember when Linwood was having problems coming to terms with our firefighters, but I don't think we ever went 3 years without a contract. And I would suggest that a policy board that hangs their union out to dry for that long has some serious issues. That's all.
Councilmember Sutton.
Thank you very much. I guess I just want to say that it's really hard to sit down and have a fair conversation with people who per se take a hard line, because that means that they've already made up their mind, and it's awfully hard to change that mindset. Now, with that, I do concur with Councilmember Cotton. I think that's an excellent idea in terms of giving an option from this diocese. I don't feel, again, that to have to be held hostage, which I feel, that's what I'm feeling right now. When someone's, this is a business, it's really important for all sides. And if we're going to start having already stipulations and a hard line, what else is going to be happening that we can't foresee? So I guess I'm not vested in either one of these either, but by the same token, what I'm hearing and the behavior that is starting to come out, I'm not sure that we're right now can make the decision. Are we trying to make a decision tonight? No, we're not. Okay. Okay. So we're still talking about it. All right. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Sarah.
In fairness and fair representation to the planning committee members that are not represented here tonight, while they did draw a line in the sand on this particular issue, it is not fair to categorize them as being unwilling to negotiate at the table around a many number of issues. Some of those were expressed today, their willingness to go with a district option, which was not their preference, and their flexibility in meeting the budget needs and the reserve amounts from the city and taking on liabilities. So there's been a great number of issues that have been discussed and voted on at the planning committee level that has represented, I think, a more fair-minded approach. And while, yes, they have taken a hard line on this particular issue, I hope that we are fairly representing the representation that they are providing at the planning committee level.
Yes, to add to that, I mean, I think the comment was, especially from, I think, Commissioner Schrock, was that they feel that they have been more than fair in some of the adjustments and some of the compromises that they have made. And so that this one issue is where they think that perhaps they don't, I don't want to say they don't want to compromise, but I mean, okay, they said it's a deal breaker, so I guess that's true. As I ramble along, but yes, the impression from the commissioners is that they have done a lot to make this work, and that perhaps we should reconsider. I'm talking for them, not for me. Thank you.
Councilmember Cotton.
And I would just echo that, you know, I think that it's been equal. I think the city's done a really good job of coming to the table and saying, yeah, okay, you know, you give a little, we'll give a little. So, I mean, we don't want to get into that because I think it'll just, well, we gave you that and you gave us this. But I would think sitting at the table, it's been a very equitable sharing of give and take. I think this is just the last issue, and hey, it always comes down to the last issue, right?
Council President?
Thank you. It was brought up earlier this evening that several years ago, Linwood discussed an RFA, and that was with, I think, seven different cities, which made that much more difficult. But one of the sticking points, again, was the governance issue. And I think that was more when you have the five commissioners and then seven cities that all want representation, you know, how do you come together to get that representation for everyone that wants it and needs it? We have an opportunity to work with the fire district and discussions about an RFA, which is what we're doing now, to determine, is that the best thing for the city of Linwood? Right now, I know it seems to us that the stance that they've taken, and even some of the commissioners have mentioned that this, you know, this particular issue about governance is a deal breaker to them. And I don't want, what I'm hoping is that when our representatives go back to the planning committee meeting, that the stance that we take is not that same stance. I would encourage us to be amenable and flexible, realizing that, you know, yes, there is give and take, and there are things that we may need to give up, and there are things that they may need to give up. But I think overall, the benefit to the city from having commissioners that are willing to work with us is way beyond what's happening here. And so I want to make sure that we let them know that. I mean, if we're going to work together, we're going to have to work together on everything. And, you know, whether we give them this, whether we take from this, I don't think that matters to me as much as an attitude of cooperation and being willing to work. And I know that, as far as I can see, we're doing that, and they've done that, as was mentioned, the commissioners have done that. So I guess what I'm trying to get at is, as we approach the discussion about this governance and the seeming hard line that they've taken, that we are open to listening to why they have those ideas and why they have those thoughts, and expect also that they will listen to us and our concerns with that, as we share, you know, why we don't see that as beneficial to the citizens of Linwood as they may, and hopefully, you know, come to a better agreement and allowing what we need for this to actually work out and go to a vote of the people to do so. So I'll just ask that as you go to the committee that you keep that in mind and keep an open mind and open negotiations and allow us to see what it is that they really have a concern about. One of the concerns that I have, though, is what Councilmember Boyer brought up, that if they're that hard-lined about it, what is their root purpose? Why are they doing that? Is it for the citizens of the fire district? It would be very difficult for me to believe that's the case if they're not willing to budge at all. So just keep that in mind, if you would.
All right, anything else?
Mayor.
Got what you need? Yes, Jared? Brett. Oh, Brett, excuse me. Quiet,
I'd like
Brett.
Sarah, real quick, maybe go over the timeline and when the meetings are. We're getting down to crunch time now, and
it's not on a screen slide, but the planning committee will be reconvening on Monday to hopefully make final decisions about what to put into the draft plan. We will be before you next Wednesday to review that plan with you. It's quite lengthy, and we hope to have it in your packets ahead of time. We'll do our best. And we'll go through the high and low points, if you will. And then there will be time for you to think about it, consider it, deliberate on it. And then we are queued up for you to take potential action on approving that plan through a joint resolution on the 24th of April. If you are not ready to take action on the 24th, there is, I think, an opportunity to convert something later down the road before we hit our deadline. Thank you. That's not on this particular schedule, but you can do a special session, I think. We can plan for a special session if we're not able to approve the plan on the 24th. And also, as previously mentioned, there is an outreach meeting at the Lynnwood Senior Center this Wednesday with Root Beer Floats, yes, and a presentation by Chief Redding. Don't want to miss that. And then while this is happening on our side, Fire District 1 commissioners have a series of meetings of their own to deliberate and discuss on the plan. What is key is that the plan itself, through the joint resolution, you and the Board of Commissioners have to adopt identical plans and adopt the same language in the joint resolution. So that's where we're going with the Planning Committee on Monday to get the final language so that we can present to you the final plan.
Can we reveal the name? Has Chief Dahl released the domain?
We have several, so we're good.
The Planning Committee today determined that the name of the RFA should be the South Snohomish County Regional Fire and Fire and Rescue. No, regional. South Snohomish County Fire and Rescue.
Got it.
The good news is, if you're not totally in love with that, the RFA board can always change the name later.
Your Honor, I move to adjourn.
Second, anybody?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.